The first question would be, it's rather unusual for a young woman to be a star researcher in computer science. How did that happen?
Well, I don't know if I'd call myself a star researcher, but yeah, I don't know. You know, I just, from a young age, I think I was very interested in science. I remember actually in third grade, I had a course on, my teacher taught a section of a science class on rocks. And I just got so excited about rocks. I was picking up rocks everywhere. And I think, you know, as I got older, I always felt drawn to the different science topics in class. And when I got into sixth grade, actually, I started doing some science fair projects, and I continued that off and on into, through high school. And I think that that was where I kind of really saw research for the first time, and I was excited by it, and, you know, excited by what, you know, these unknown questions. It was so much different than a homework set where you might, you know, you just monotonously go down and solve problems that kind of have, you know, that there's a solution even if it's difficult to solve it. But research was this new kind of way of thinking and problem solving, and I think I found that really exciting. But it wasn't really that I got into computer science until I actually, it was in high school. I had taken I had signed up for some class, and they actually canceled the class. I forget why. Maybe there wasn't enough participation, enough people signed up for it. And in place of that class, I was like, what am I going to do? It was only a couple days before the semester, and so I thought about taking a study hall, you know, have a little bit less of a course load that year. But I decided eventually, my friend actually convinced me to take a computer science class. And at first I was like, I don't want to do this. This doesn't seem very fun. You know, what am I going to use computer science for? But eventually he convinced me that I should do it. And I took the class, and it was like, it was, you know, opened up a whole new world. You know, the class, you know, we didn't solve any big problems or anything. Probably the biggest problem we had is programming fish to move around a checkerboard. But actually that opened up a whole other area for me, because I had done this computer science class. I was actually offered, and I learned this new language of computing, I was offered a position in my the college in my hometown, Purdue University. I was offered a position to work in a lab that summer to help the graduate student researchers with their projects. And so that was the first time that I got experience with real research, I guess, and I got to see what they were working on, and it was, they were working on problems in imaging. In particular, it was working on some image forensics problems, so learning from a camera, from a digital image, can you identify what camera took that picture? And by using basically statistics in the noise. And I just found that so exciting. It was how we could pull out hidden information from images, and I thought that, and it was amazing to be able to, you know, interpret the world around us and understand the underlying physics of what is happening, and use that knowledge to recover some hidden properties about the world. And so from that, I kind of got more interested in imaging and electrical engineering, and eventually computer vision, which is also very rooted in computer science. And so I feel like, you know, my path, it's weaved in and out, but I've always just been driven by a love of research and images too. And because I really like that you get to, in imaging work, you get to visualize what you're working on. And I think that that is really fun.
Now, the project of imaging a black hole is very interdisciplinary, right? It has astrophysicists, it has mathematicians, statisticians, computer scientists, engineers, optics specialists, and so on. How was it to work in such a very interdisciplinary team while being a PhD student, postdoc, which is usually relatively disciplinary in fashion?
It was a different experience, but I had a lot of fun. I kind of stumbled across the project, and I got into it in my second year of my PhD. They had, at that point, worked a lot on the instrumentation side of the project, but were just starting to get into the imaging. And so they were in a big need of someone who who worked on imaging to come in and try to interpret the data and develop new methods to deal with all the challenges that they had. When I heard about the project, actually, it was through a presentation. And I remember understanding basically nothing that they were saying. I understood, okay, I know what a Fourier transform is. There's images in there. I've heard of black holes before, but that's pretty much it. The rest of it was kind of gibberish. But despite that, I left the meeting being like, I want to work on this project because it just sounded so much fun. And I could also see that really the tools that they needed for this project were so similar to the tools that we developed for other problems, like in medical imaging or just across computer vision and image processing. You see a lot of similar problems. When I got onto the team, you know, I didn't know anything about black holes, but I have worked with such an amazing set of collaborators who were willing to, you know, let me push myself into the team. And through the process, they taught me, you know, everything I know about radio astronomy, about black holes, astrophysics. I didn't take any classes. It's all through them kindly teaching me this. And so I think it was, and through different parts of the project, theory, instrumentation, I got to spend time at a telescope about a month and a half of time and learn about the receivers and the whole system. And I think it was really important, actually, that I learned that the collaborators that I had taught me all these different pieces, because when you are developing an imaging method, you have to understand what are the errors in the data, you know, and how do problems that come about during observation make their way into the data that we're analyzing. You also have to understand, what do we expect in the data? Do we expect evolution over the course of a night, things like this. So it comes from both sides, the theory, the instrumentation. And so really it was essential that every piece of this project, that you know a little bit about all the different fields in order to get the most out of the data. So I think working on interdisciplinary teams is so crucial now for so much big science and projects going forward, because we're really, you know, trying to squeeze the most out of data, and it's necessary to understand each part of it.
Now, in such a large team and interdisciplinary project, there was no problem to be accepted as probably a junior member of the team, as the dynamics of the group and so on, which sometimes is not so easy in big science projects. What is your experience there?
Yeah, well, actually, the Event Horizon Telescope project is, I think, primarily driven by junior scientists, the early career scientists, graduate students, postdocs, lots of postdocs, and young researchers. And I think that they're the heart of the team. The thing is, with a lot of big science, that you know, the top people, the directors, the project scientists, these positions get most of the most name recognition. And for that reason, it's unfortunate that a lot of times these early career researchers who were so essential for the success of the project kind of get unnamed. They're definitely on the papers, but aren't as recognized publicly. And so I think that this is something that we have to understand going forward in big science projects, that now, in order to do important research in science, a lot of times you do have to form these big teams, and we have to make sure that we recognize people for doing collaboration work that was so essential, and because it's just not the original old publishing model that we had like 100 years ago. So this is something that I'm really trying to push in the collaboration, that we come up with new ways of recognizing the important contributions of early career scientists so that other members of their community know how important their work was.
This is very nice, and you got a great recognition as a team, which is a breakthrough prize. Can you say a little bit about this?
Yeah, I was so excited to hear that we had won the Breakthrough Prize. And I think that the Breakthrough Prize is wonderful for a number of reasons, but one is that I think it really recognizes the full collaboration. And a lot of awards these days are given to individuals, and that's wonderful too, but for now, as I said, science is often having to be done in these big collaborations, and so having prizes that recognize that and spread out the wealth and recognition to the entire team, I think, is really wonderful to see. And it's also a sign that the community recognizes that this is something that going forward we have to learn, change the model of how teams are recognized.
Now, having such a key result like imaging the first black hole very early in your career, is, of course, fantastic, but it brings me to the question, what else are you going to discover? What are your plans now that you are an independent young faculty member at Caltech?
As I said, I'm not an astrophysicist. I come from the electrical engineering and computer science background. And so before, during my PhD, although I was mostly focused in my later years on the black hole imaging work, I actually did a lot of other projects too. Some stuff in medical imaging, some in material estimation, a couple other projects as well. And so now that I've started as a assistant professor at Caltech, I'm really excited to get back into doing some other projects. So I'm starting some work in seismology, trying to image earthquakes, which is very important for California. Also doing some, trying to get back into some materials work that I used to do before. Also doing some stuff in climate science and studying clouds through imaging. So lots of different, I'm so excited about Caltech because it's a small school, it makes it very easy to connect with people across these disciplines. I've been so fortunate to already be connected to start working with faculty in all these in lots of different areas. And going forward, I think, you know, my ultimate goal is to think about how can we use new tools, new computational tools, machine learning, artificial intelligence to help us as scientists discover new things. You know, we're so used to coming up with ourselves a hypothesis, and then we go off and we figure out, okay, what should we observe to test this hypothesis? But actually, a lot of times we can develop machines that find trends in data that we might not see as humans. We might not notice these trends. And so I'm really excited also about how can we design machines to tell us how to do our experiments going forward, what new wavelength to look in, what new data domain to look in order to discover something that we would not even know of otherwise. So I think in general, I'm just really interested in how do we do data-driven scientific discovery.
Machine learning and AI sometimes give you answers which are not understandable by humans. Mm. Is that a problem for the business of science?
I think so. I think it is important that we, going forward, one of the biggest priorities is that for machine learning, we make it interpretable. One thing that I think, there's a number of reasons. The first obvious thing is I think in science experiments, when you present the results, you need error bars, right? And a lot of times, current methods in machine learning aren't very good at giving you error bars. they're good at giving you, you know, based on the data that you've trained, what it thinks the best answer is, but they don't naturally give error bars. And usually we kind of finagle some way to get some error bars from them. But for science, that is a priority. So I think one thing is we really have to think about uncertainty when we're developing machine learning tools. Uncertainty quantification is crucial. But second is that we really need to have the tools that we develop need to be interpretable. One reason that there's so much pushback to using these new computational tools, these machine learning, is that when you train it on a bunch of data and then you apply it to your data, if you don't the data that you've collected, you might not understand what it's doing. And so you just don't trust the results that come out in the end. Especially because when we train these networks, that we have to train them with some underlying model in mind, right? And in reality, usually we don't know exactly the model. For instance, in the case of the black hole, we don't know the Event Horizon Telescope. We don't know exactly all the noise that's on the telescope system that we're working with. And so there's always this model mismatch between what we train these networks on, these machine learning networks on, and what the actual true underlying model is of the system that we are collecting data from. And that will always affect the results that we get, and we don't know how it's going to affect them. So I think that it's really important that, one, we blend physics and our knowledge about how the world works into these computational tools so that they're invariant, they're much more robust, at least, to these type of model mismatch errors, or at least we understand where the how the model mismatch will affect the result. And I just think that the tools that we develop, we have to understand, for instance, if we train a deep learning network to do the same thing that a physics model-based approach takes, we have to understand, well, what is it actually doing to the data? And does it agree with what we'd expect it should do in certain scenarios?
Speaking of noisy signals and astrophysics, 25 years ago, a couple of guys, a professor and his graduate student, discovered the first exoplanet, which is very similar in discovery as imaging the black hole. And what do you say about, you know, running the experiments? Of course, you know, they just got the Nobel Prize in physics, so this was all over the press. So the graduate student, you know, when he had the measurements of, you know, the transit of the planet in front of a star, he didn't believe the results. He did, because it was so astonishing that he had to rerun the experiments. That was not machine learning. That was doing it by hand. But he just couldn't believe he had actually seen the first transit of an exoplanet. So things have changed, but it's still very noisy data, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, and I'll say that when we first created the black hole image, or at least the first day when we got the data and we ran our imaging scripts and the ring appeared, I actually was going between awe, excitement, and also, like, I was very mad at my friend who had given us the data because I thought that he gave us fake data. It just seemed too good to be true. I mean, nothing ever works like that the first time, and it was so much more beautiful than any synthetic data we had even created. And so it wasn't actually for weeks that I really believed that this was the real data and that they weren't just trying to trick us to test us.